But it'll be back up shortly. If you're on Facebook, it'll be right back. But here we are. Happy, this is what I heard this morning. Happy sequester. Sequester. Took me a minute to get that. But, you know, as I think about all of the holidays, the popular holidays that people celebrate, Easter to me is a holiday about kind of turning in and going into that quiet place and taking time away from our ordinary lives. Because Easter is that moment where we're finally rising into awakening into our own higher consciousness. That we rise above our limitations, we rise above the conditions that are present in our life to go into our Christ consciousness, to embody the Christ consciousness, our great I am. Our higher consciousness is not about walking on water. It's about being fully alive in this present moment and making choices that honor our divine nature, that expansive nature of who we really are. No matter what's going on in the world outside of us, no matter what conditions are present in our life, we always are at choice, and we get to choose if we are responding to our environment. And when we respond to our environment, we call forth greater things through us. We have the choice to pay attention to our thinking and know if we're reacting, if we're caught in a mental tendency that's keeping us stuck. So there is a lot that goes on in the Easter story. In fact, Easter is the culmination. Easter is kind of the happy ending of a long story that's all about the journey to transformation. And so it starts off with, the Easter story starts really with Jesus going into the wilderness for 40 days. That he goes into the wilderness to fast, to battle his adversary, to release temptation, and there he accepts his sacred assignment. And so he, Palm Sunday, he shows up in Jerusalem. He returns to Jerusalem. He knows he fits the bill as the Messiah. He has accepted his title of the Christ. And so now he's living his sacred assignment. Now he is embodying it. And then there's the Last Supper. Okay, the Last Supper, where Jesus has to face the struggle that we all face when we take on a sacred assignment, and it's that we might have to do a hard thing that we don't want to do. And then he went through the crucifixion, where it was a painful letting go of the old life. For 3 days, he rested in the tomb, and he said that he was rest in the heart of the earth. And that's where he rested in God and called together his spiritual resources to make the great big demonstration Easter morning, where he rose as a fully conscious, enlightened being. He was a being of light. In the stories in the Bible, he's light, and like people can't even touch him because he's light. So the entire Easter story has a template that is important to us because right now, we are at the beginning of a journey that we have never taken before. And that's how the new chapter in our hero's story always starts off. We face a condition we've never had to face before. There's always going to be a condition present that we cannot change. So this Easter, I say, today is the start of a journey we've never taken before. But I believe I'm going to say that for the next 20 Easters. Okay, this Easter, we're at the beginning of a new journey. Because there's always going to be some condition present in our life that we can't change. So we might struggle against it at first, but then we'll be able to rise above it and we'll expand our consciousness. And this is what Jesus's ministry was about. There will always be a condition to struggle against. He wasn't teaching about living the dream, right? Getting your dream job, your dream partner, having that dream life, living, you know, some big, great, special purpose, because that was not an option for the people of Jesus's time. They were people who lived under oppression. Now, we may have opportunities afforded to us because we live in this time. We live in a time where if we want to, we can dedicate, if not all of our life, we can dedicate a good portion of our life to some kind of a sport or a creative expression or a science or a craft. We can do that now. But back in Jesus's time, people didn't have those kind of options. The life they were born into was the life that they had for life. Daughters would grow up to have the same life as their mother. Sons would grow up to have the same life as their father. Nobody got to choose if they wanted to be a doctor or a poet or study astronomy. Unless you were born into a wealthy class, if your life was physically demanding and you had a life of hardship, it would remain a life that was physically demanding. It would remain a life of hardship. So Jesus's ministry was about focusing on rising above the condition that couldn't be changed. Okay, he was teaching how to accept the things that cannot be changed and transcend it. He was teaching personal inner transformation. Because anybody who experiences personal inner transformation, they will experience transformation in their life. They'll experience transformation in how they show up in everything that they do, how they show up in the life that they were given, how they show up in their relationships, in their job, and in the ways that they are of service. So Jesus wasn't teaching about finding an expensive, new, special lifestyle. He taught to open the heart, to see, to connect with the spirit within, to connect with heaven within, with that creative source, that substance that works through us, for us, as us, so that even in a life of hardship, his people could call forth grace and grit. They could call forth the grace that it took and the grit that it took to live in those times, that they could still be a radiating center of peace, a love amplifier, a grace generator, and they could still call forth the inner fortitude, the resilience and the courage that it took to be fully alive in those present, in those moments of their life, right? To bring forth the gifts that a life of joy demanded, in spite of it being a life of hardship. So this is all about spiritual transformation. Easter is about spiritual transformation. It's not about what I have and what I do. It's about what I am, how I do what I do. But somewhere in the last, 30 years, I kind of saw it in the late 80s because I lived it. But this hybrid spirituality was born that was all about happiness, right? All about, if you just follow these steps, everything will be perfect. Life will be amazing. You'll have your soulmate. You'll live your dream. You'll have your dream job. You'll have a higher special purpose that lets you stand out from everybody else who's ordinary. And if you do everything right, life will be perfect. And I believed that for a long time. Okay, that it would be, my life would be totally perfect and happy if I did everything perfect, right? If I did it perfectly. But that's not the case. I mean, if you look at Jesus suffered, even though he had this divine awareness of the truth of things, even though he saw the Father within, the heaven within, all people besides himself, even though he performed miracles and taught that everything he could do, everybody else could do too. Okay, Jesus was divinely aware, but he still suffered. He worried about the hearts of his people. He worried about what would happen to his disciples after he was gone. And so we can fall into this spiritual narcolepsy where we forget who we are, we forget who we serve, we forget what we came here to do. We forget what it means to be free. And because when we're on autopilot, we're stuck in the spiral of a mental tendency and we keep habitually doing the same thing over and over without thinking about it. We habitually have the same reactions to life without thinking about how we're thinking. if we've fallen under spiritual narcolepsy, we'll go into a holding pattern. And that holding pattern in our life, it might look something like this. I just know I'm designed to do something bigger. I mean, I feel like there's something big I'm supposed to be calling forth through myself, but I don't know what that is. But I know that it's big and will change my life, right? We might think that. There'll be this dissatisfaction with our current life just the way that it is, and we might find ourselves waiting for something out here to change. So then we can start living our purpose. We might know kind of what we want to do, but then we're waiting for the guarantee that if we do this thing that we dream of doing and sounds good, we'll have the guarantee that we get our happy ending, that we make money, that we're healthy, we're loved, we have a great partner. But until then, while we're in that holding pattern, waiting for all this to happen, we feel like we want to be anywhere but right here in this present life. Okay, anywhere. And this is what happens in the first chapter of this series that we're in. That's a story of our life. We are a series of amazing books, amazing tales, right? We're not just a one-hit wonder, not just one book with a happy ending and it just ends right there. We get happy endings and then we start over again. Okay, so think about Luke Skywalker, right? I saw Star Wars when I was a little kid, A New Hope. And when it ended, I thought that was the happy ending and they were fine after that. I didn't know there'd be 5 more stories about Luke Skywalker. I didn't know the Empire would strike back and the Jedi would return and the Force would awaken and all that, right? I thought after Star Wars, that happy ending was enough. Okay, but it's not. Our life is a series of stories. So Luke Skywalker felt that at the beginning of his story. He didn't want to be in the life he was in right in that moment. He wanted to do something bigger. He wanted to be off with his friends who were fighting, right? He was dissatisfied with his current life and he wanted to be anywhere but his current life. Then he met Obi-Wan Kenobi. And Obi-Wan says, "Oh, we have an adventure to take." And what does Luke say? "I can't go with you on this adventure. I have to stay home." He didn't want to stay home. But he didn't want to go on an adventure. And this is the story of our life. Okay, it's a repeating process. It's a story. We get into this way of living. We don't really want, I mean, we dream of the adventure, but it seems too big. We don't want to have to put in all that effort. It's a repeating process. And so that's why I love the Easter story, because the Easter story, it's a blueprint, all right? It's a template for every time we start this process over again. And so the template starts with the 40 days in the wilderness. Say 40 days in the wilderness. Because 40 days metaphysically is how long it takes to deny that a condition can have any power over us. Right? Every time we're faced with a condition that we've never had to face before, something happens. Okay, this thing happens. And that thing is this. We are tempted to blame the condition for how our life's not working. Now, when we blame the condition, the next thing that happens is we surrender everything that we are to the condition. So now it has power over us. So we've blamed it. Now we move into victimhood and depression and despair. And then suddenly we're a cautionary tale for what happens if we're not stepping into our own life. We become a warning instead of a great example. Okay, so that happens when we are faced with the temptation to blame the condition. Now Jesus faced temptation. So we have to face the temptation too. We have to make the choice to abstain from giving our power away. Jesus fasted for 40 days. He abstained from the temptation. And that's the root of addiction, is giving authority to something outside of ourselves over and over and over again, even though it spins us out. We give our authority to it again, and it takes more from us every time we give our power to it. It takes more from us. you can think of a typical addiction, like alcohol, drugs, food, shopping, gambling, sex, computer gaming. But you know where else we can get addicted? We can get addicted in the cycle of blaming and complaining and gossiping. We can get addicted to the cycle of needing approval from outside of ourselves. Because as long as we need somebody else to approve of what we're doing in our life, we don't ever have to actually do the hard stuff. Okay, we can get addicted to being in victim consciousness. Oh, these bad things happen to me and oh, there's nothing I can do about it. Somebody else will write in and take care of this for me. Somebody else will handle this for me. We can get addicted to having pain and illness. Now, I worked in holistic healing for 20 years. This runs rampant in our culture because so many of us are not taught how to be assertive, that assertiveness is good. Assertiveness is to live in integrity, to know what we want and live our truth. But we're not taught to be assertive. If we're not assertive, we can't set boundaries. So our illness, our pain, it keeps us from doing the things we don't want to do. Having others do more for us than we're willing to do for ourselves, that can be an addiction. Being unworthy can be an addiction because we're constantly thinking, okay, I'm not good enough right now. What I need is this and this and one more thing and one more workshop and one more whatever. I need to lose some weight. I need to gain some weight. Okay, and then I'll be worthy. But see, while we're in the addiction of unworthiness, we don't have to actually do anything to change our life. So being unworthy, that can also be an addiction. All these addictions that we face up to in this 40 days, we're going to have to dive deep into a place we've never gone before that's within us. We're going to have to dive deep. So it's 40 days because it takes time for us to go that deep and create new responses to these conditions. It takes time to rewire our brain so that we can claim our inner authority. We've been told, and I wish it were true, but we've been told 7 days to a new habit or 21 days to a new habit. I've personally never had that experience, ever. Last year when I gave up sugar, I was at 90 days of being sugar-free, and I still wanted to choke anybody who carried around a bag of M&Ms. Okay, I still was not out of my addiction to sugar at 90 days of abstaining from it. So at least 40 days, that's the metaphysical number, 40 days of abstaining from a behavior that harms us so we can embody a new shiny version of ourselves. So that's 40 days. And then Palm Sunday, okay, where Jesus accepted the title of the Christ, we accept our spiritual truth, that we too are an emanation of that. We too have the Christ within us. We live by our spiritual authority, who we are, what we came here to do, who it is that we serve. And then we face another struggle. See, we claim our spiritual authority. Now we have to start changing our lives. We're going to be called to do something that's outside of our comfort zone, and it's going to take effort. Anytime we've ever created change in our lives, it's taken a lot of effort. This was so hard for Jesus that when he went to the garden to pray in Gethsemane, he suffered because he knew what he had to do and he didn't want to do it. We know what we have to do, and it's going to be hard, and it's going to be out of our comfort zone. I have never, ever, ever met someone who was a strong person who didn't also have to struggle and suffer through situations. That's how we're becoming strong is what we're doing. We're developing stamina. We're being a soul with stamina. So we go into our 40 days in the wilderness. We face the behaviors that don't serve us. We accept our divine truth, and then we face that we will have to do some hard things. Every person that I have known who's gone through a divorce, that wasn't easy for them to do. Somebody who's had to quit a job, or maybe they've started a job that they don't feel qualified for. If we decide that we want to embody physical strength and stamina. We want to get really, really healthy. The big heart thing we have to do is changing our diet. Okay, for me, I was getting up at like 4:30 to be at my working in class at 6 a.m. Now the hard thing I'm doing is trying to remember that it meets at a different time because now it's online. If we want to write a book, the hard thing is going to be giving up sitting in front of Netflix and drinking coffee instead of writing, right? Dedicating 2 hours a morning to writing something. Starting a garden. It's one thing to look out at your backyard and imagine an amazing garden. It is quite another to get out there before the crack of dawn every morning, digging, hauling dirt around. It's physical labor and it's hard work. Somebody wants a dream home, their dream home. For me, the first part of that looks like giving up the frivolous spending to have a savings account. That's hard. That's hard work, decluttering. We cannot do the behaviors that keep us from having what we want and also have what we want. The door's not both open and shut. It's one thing. Okay, so that's what we're facing. Okay, we face up to the fact that we're going to be doing a hard thing to change our life. Okay, when we start following divine guidance, okay, that inner instruction from our inner being, we may be overhauling our life. We may be overhauling our life. So then we get to the crucifixion. The crucifixion is about letting go of the old thoughts and beliefs, the old ways of thinking, and then dealing with the fact that it is likely going to turn our world upside down. Giving up old beliefs can tear us apart. When we are changing our lives, we can actually end up in the dark night of the soul. And we are looking inward then, and we're finding so many places within us that need healing. When I changed my diet, when I turned my diet upside down in 2019, I cannot believe all the stuff that came up. So much that needed healing. When we start making changes and letting go of old patterns that hold us back, that is revealed what needs to be healed. And we have to dig deeper into compassion than we have ever gone. Okay, that's the crucifixion. Okay, that tearing up in the healing. Next, Jesus spent 3 days in the tomb. In his words, he said, 3 nights, 3 days in the heart of the earth. He was resting in God and at the same time gathering strength for the power of a greater demonstration that would follow. And that's what we are doing. We rest in God. We embody the awareness of who we are, where we come from, and what we are here to do, right? Who we are here to serve. And then it's Easter. Easter. Jesus gathered forth his spiritual resources and he rose bright and early. He was a fully conscious being, fully enlightened, fully lit soul is what he was. We go 40 days into the desert. We accept our truth. We do the hard things. We do the inner work of healing that we have to do because we've been tore up. And then we gather our spiritual resources. And then it's our day to rise and shine too. Our day to rise and shine. To be who we are. Be who we are. Live out loud. Okay, bring all that is within us, through us, for us, as us, and into our life. That's our purpose, to live our life by calling forth all that is within us. And Jesus did really miraculous things. He multiplied the fishes and the loaves. He raised the dead, healed the sick. He walked on water. He calmed the storms. And we have miraculous things that we are doing too. And our miraculous things are all about our interconnectedness with each other. That we rise to this challenge, this current condition, and every condition that we didn't ask for that will follow. We rise to these conditions by remembering that our life and our purpose, they're not about what we have. It's not about our stuff. It's not about what we're doing. It's about our life, and our purpose is about who we are and how we do what we do. Martin Luther King said one of the greatest prayers I have ever heard. He said, "Use me, God. Show me how to take who I am, who I want to be, and what I can do, and use it for a purpose greater than myself." Now, this is what Jesus did. Use me. This is how he lived. This is how he taught. He never said, "Well, what's in it for me? Well, that's, I don't want to do that one part because it's going to be really hard. And if you take care of these things, all right, maybe." Okay, he never said that. He never said, "What's in it for me?" And he performed miracles. And he changed the course of history. He changed life as we know it. So our miracles are all about how we show up in this life, how we show up in our relationships. Right? Are we showing up with an open heart and an authenticity and acceptance? Or are we showing up thinking how we don't trust that person and what are they going to try to get out of us? Like, what does this relationship have in it for me? Okay, how will we show up in our jobs? Right? Are we giving our very best to this job and being grateful that we have it right now? Or are we complaining about it to anybody who will listen? How do we show up even just driving a car? Right? How are we speaking about others throughout our day? Are we calling them idiots? I found myself calling somebody maybe an idiot this last week. I feel bad about it now. How are we speaking to ourselves? I found myself calling myself an idiot. I called myself stupid for something I did. That's not supporting me. What is our self-talk? How are we showing up in our own relationship with ourself? Do we have that compassion? Do we have that deep love? So this is what we can do. We can ask ourselves, how am I showing up in this experience of being fully alive? How am I bringing all that a life of joy requires? How am I bringing that? All the things that a life of joy requires from me. What am I calling forth? Marianne Williamson said, "Each of us has a unique part to play in the healing of the world." And I think she said this in a book that's like 8 or 9 years old. But here we are, right here, right now. There is a healing of the world taking place, and what part are we playing in that healing? Okay, we each have a unique part to play, but it's not about specialness. It's about the energy that we bring. All of us, because each of us are an individuated soul, our energy blueprint or print is different, just like all of our thumbprints are different. We have a unique energetic blueprint, and that's what we're bringing into this life every day. We bring our energy into the situation. So what kind of energy are we bringing? Moment by moment, we are bringing energy into this that we're living. Okay, so are we giving in to temptation and blaming outside conditions? Or are we stepping into our spiritual authority? Are we giving up because things seem hard or take a lot of effort? Or are we doing those hard things so we can be the person who has that new shiny experience instead of being the person who wishes they could have that experience? Are we letting go of the old way of living even though it is tearing us up to do it? Are we allowing ourselves to rest in the truth that we are created to be creators? We are not created to be sit around and waiters. Okay, we're not created to sit around and wait. Living out loud, this is how we be who we are. This is how we bring our purpose into this life. Okay, living, calling all of this through us and into our life, that is our purpose. And that is how we create heaven on earth. So until next time, remember, You are the activity of spirit in a body, and you are the heart and the hands of spirit in this world. You are soul designed for growth and goodness. You are designed to do all of this stuff. You are designed to do this. In everything you do, you are blessed. And so it is.